Across France, there are thousands of beautiful chateaux. Many are being brought back to life.
If you think it's going to go, run.
By adventurous Brits.
With a bit of brute force, they'll come out with a sledgehammer.
They're taking on the challenge.
Watch your...
Oh, this is so scary.
To transform these once unloved buildings.
I'm used to starting these big things. Finishing it is the haunting part of it.
Into incredible homes.
Oh, wow. Oh, my God. That is amazing.
And businesses.
Come on in.
There'll be triumphs.
Come on. I can't believe it.
And setbacks.
The cab is too tall to get into the building.
But however hard the going gets...
It's pretty difficult marketing something that isn't finished, so I don't want to lie to people.
Those who've made the move.
You've got it back in. It's beautiful.
Thank you so much.
Get to live the dream... ...as custodians of their very own castle. Today, wedding hosts butt heads over a poolside project...
And what is the option?
Well, install a post in the middle.
In the middle. That's gonna ruin it aesthetically.
One chateau owner has big plans for an outbuilding.
And this is gonna be a cinema games room.
Okay. So we should have that done by tea time.
By tea time next year.
And a sheet conversion hits a stumbling block.
It won't go in.
Oh, we're touching the side almost.
Hitting the stone.
I'm not sure who's the more confused in there at the moment.
Surrounded by acres of beautiful vineyards in the southwest of France is the palatial 15th century Chateau Lagorce. Boasting 20 grand bedrooms, it's home to Edward, Kosovan-born Anna, and their two children, Charles and Emma. Costing £890,000 in 2003, the couple now run it as a thriving luxury wedding venue.
The best part of living in the chateau, it's waking up every day to a majestic view. There's wildlife.
The kids absolutely love to go feed the fish, play in their chateau treehouse. I don't think there's probably a better place for kids to grow up, to be fair.
It's just a beautiful way of life.
Situated half an hour away from Bordeaux, keeping this grand home and business running is a constant effort. To enhance their offering to guests, 2 years ago the couple decided to upgrade the pool area and build a brand new pool house.
Yeah.
As perfect as it is, Anna has since decided that there's still room for improvement.
We have really hot summers. It's not unheard of that the temperatures go over 40 and in the sun it can reach 45. I thought it would be nice to have a covered area where we have like an outside drinks area set up and then guests come for a drink. Whilst I'm standing in the shade.
Anna's plan is to have a terracotta tiled roof on the front of the pool house, supported by a timber frame, but it's causing Edward a problem.
The building is actually wider than the kind of paved area around the pool. If I overhang, then there's a piece of wood coming down the side there, and I don't like the idea of that, so probably have it somewhere just finishing, somewhere just above this window here, if I'm allowed.
Perfectionist Anna may not go for the idea of a lean-to that doesn't go all the way to the left edge of the building.
Do you think we could do something else? Because I would prefer it if it was slightly toward the end of the build, if you can come up with something.
If we go that way anymore, we're not going to have the post on here. I'm going to have to do a post in the ground, and I have to wait for that to set before I can carry on and to cure.
You found a solution.
It's a load more work, but I think it's the right decision.
With the new plan in place, the pair start to attach the wooden frame that will support the new roof.
Is it going?
Yeah.
Not easy, is it?
No.
The next decision they need to make is how much headroom there will be underneath the canopy.
I think maximum we're going to be at 2 metres for the bottom of the...
Oh, yeah, 2 metres is good, because... I mean, there's not many people that are going to be taller than 2 meters.
need to do pretty much the same thing on the other side now, keeping it all parallel and square. I don't think I'm far off being level.
No, you're not.
How's that?
That is almost perfect. I think this is it.
After one final check...
Yep, that'll do me.
The new frame will soon be ready to start tiling.
Are you happy with that, Anna?
Really happy.
Good. That's the main thing.
But now Edward needs to make a concrete base for the outer post and wait for it to set before the structure will be readied. In the Nouvelle Aquitaine region is the medieval Chateau Mareuil. Dating back to the 1400s, it has 17 rooms, 5 outbuildings, and a swimming pool. Its current owners are Belinda, a former commercial director, and Lee, a lighting designer, who bought the chateau nearly 7 years ago for £378,000.
This was actually built as a kind of, well, the common parlance would be a medieval police station, really. It was ruling the areas around.
Keeping law and order locally.
Keeping law and order. And so there was a small army of people.
Didn't work for you, though, did it?
The magic of the building. I've got you, darling. Yeah. There's no law and order with you, is there?
Located an hour east of historic Poitiers, the couple run a booming B&B business. To increase the accommodation they can offer, last year they began work on an old tool shed, repairing the roof.
Yeah, we've got a hole here.
Yeah.
And that row is gone.
Ready to turn it into a two-bedroom jeet or holiday cottage. Now the roof is watertight, they've switched their attention to the interior. Today, Lee and his builder friend Terry are patching up the rustic walls.
Over the last 3 years, Belinda and I have been lucky enough to have 4 new grandchildren join the family. And the family's getting bigger all the time. So we thought, if we convert this, we've got space for the whole family. And when the family are not here, we can rent it out as a jeet and top up our income. If I stay low down this side...
Yeah.
And move across, you stay high and we cross over, yeah?
Is that perfect?
Yep. Sounds good to me.
Belinda and Lee are keen to get the jeet finished in time to rent it out this summer. But once the walls are finished, there's a whole new interior to build, and Lee isn't sure what the best design will be for the relatively small space.
Do you want to measure that then to see if it's 3.5 metres? See if it's...
Yeah, because you're limited by stairs off the shelf.
Yeah.
It's about 250.
Hello.
What's going on in here? It looks amazing.
Yeah, it's all filling in nicely. Bearing in mind what the original idea was, we was going to have the stairs going up here, feature window there, bedroom this side, bedroom that side, bathroom under the stairs.
Yeah.
I've been wrestling with this. So I've just been talking to Terry.
Yes.
About whether we could get the bathroom upstairs and 2 bedrooms upstairs and get the staircase coming in from the side here.
I mean, one thing that concerns me is, for example, having a bathroom and toilet upstairs that you have to can only access through a bedroom. And I don't think that's a very tidy solution. Because the thing is, you know, you never know, Lee, how this space is going to be used. At the moment, I can't see it, to be honest. I'm not sure who's the more confused in there at the moment. I've come out very confused. And unless I see some drawings, I can't visualise it at all.
With Belinda scuppering Lee's suggestion, it's very much back to the drawing board before work on the jeet can proceed.
Pretty pictures, that's what you need to draw.
Yeah, I need to do some drawings, I think.
Coming up. One chateau owner doesn't hold back.
I did not expect that it was going to come down that fast.
Don't make them like they used to.
It's looking transformed already.
And Edward tries to keep hold of the purse strings.
We got anything else we're picking up?
Yes, some eucalyptus trees. Some big pots around the pool. Maybe a little bit of red geraniums.
Please, stop.
Off the beaten track, in the lesser-known Creuse area of central France, stands the majestic Chateau de Jolibois. This 19th-century masterpiece is set in 1780. Parkland and boasts 14 bedrooms and 3 outbuildings. The Chateau was bought in 2017 for £308,000 by American-born Vanessa and her husband Ben, who plan to turn it into a fabulous family home for themselves and their son Max. It was the massive ballroom that sealed the deal for them.
When we first arrived and had a look around, this is the room that you walk into and you look up and you just go, wow, this is incredible.
And the doors were open,
yeah.
And the view was there, and it was captivating. So I think this room is the only reason I agreed to do this whole thing.
Approximately 200 miles south of Paris, the chateau lay abandoned for almost a decade and needs complete restoration. Last time we visited, Ben and Vanessa had made a start on renovations, taking on their favorite room first.
Lo and behold, we decided, let's just do the ballroom. It makes no sense why we did it.
We it's just entertainment.
It's entertainment. Like, space. It would be fantastic to have parties in here.
They commissioned an intricately painted fresco of family figures and started gilding the 80 meters of ornate plasterwork. Now, almost 2 years and nearly £2,000 worth of gold leaf later, their chateau's grand centerpiece is near completion.
My favorite part of in terms of what's been done most recently is all the mother inlay. So that looks amazing. It's worth it, isn't it, now that we have this?
Yeah, it's fantastic.
With the rest of the people block at the chateau, when they can find time to do more renovations. The next space they're taking on is an outbuilding that was last used when the chateau was a convalescence home.
It used to be, as far as we can tell, a laundry, because there's old washing machines and ironing boards and storage cupboards for linens and that kind of thing. And we plan to turn it into a sort of cinema, computer games room, and a gym on that side, with a nice bathroom, not a horrible, disgusting bathroom like there is at the moment.
Ben's making a start with the help of locally based handyman, Paul.
All right, so this is going to be part of the gym.
Okay.
Because we just want to open that space right up.
Okay, so we're going to take everything out?
All the internal walls, and then the ceilings need to come out as well.
Yes. But we should have that done by tea time.
By tea time next year. The beast. I got a new toy. Thor's hammer.
Tooled up, Ben gets to work on the wall that needs to come down to make space for the gym.
Well, there's a hole. There you go. I did not expect that it was going to come down that fast.
Don't make them like they used to.
There, looks like a gym already. Good girl.
A second partition wall comes down equally painlessly.
Well, there you go, one room down.
We did in about 15 minutes what I thought would take half a day. It's looking transformed already.
On a roll, they also knock out the toilet and shower cubicles. And with the space opened up, Vanessa's keen to have a look.
Oh,
look, it's all gone.
It's big! It's bigger than I thought it was going to be.
No, it's nice, isn't it?
Yeah, no, this is great. It's even hard to remember what it looked like before. This is brilliant. This is a huge step for us. This is about a gym. This is about a cinema room and a games room. That's something that we can use and our families can use whilst we're doing the rest.
There's still a long way to go before the cinema and gym are ready to enjoy, and there are plenty more jobs on the to-do list waiting to be started. Near Bordeaux, work has paused on Anna and Edward's pool house lean-to while the concrete sets around the posts. The couple are taking the opportunity to visit the local garden centre for some plants to dress the area.
White, so white and green, and it's neutral and it will go with everything.
While Anna is on the lookout for climbers and flowering plants to make the pool area pop, Edward's main concern is watching the purse strings.
I think my biggest challenge today is going to be keeping up with Anna in here, because she gets really enthusiastic. What are these?
So these are the big jasmines, so I'm thinking some of these ones, because look already, against the barrier, this is gonna grow nicely, and then it can get twisted around. So I'm thinking some of the big ones.
What about this?
So that's oleander.
I know that that's not going to grow on the fence, but I mean, you could just plant it off and just trim it.
Yeah, that is beautiful. And it has little white flowers.
I know, we're lucky.
With two different types of plants selected, they're already approaching €200, but Anna isn't done yet.
We got anything else we're picking up?
Some eucalyptus trees. Because you can never go wrong with eucalyptus. We could
have got anything else we're picking up?
Maybe a little bit of red geraniums and some flowers. Cut flowers.
Is there anything else we're picking up?
Well, hopefully not. Oh, yes. Some big pots around the pool.
Okay. Well, I'll go get the trolley and start gathering up the other plants then.
My love of flowers can annoy Ed a lot because I don't know how to stop. And then after I think, oh my goodness, why did I do that? Well, then it's too nice. It's the pleasure of the eyes and I think they transform a place. And you can never have too many flowers. No roses?
What do you want roses for?
It would look nice though, no?
Oh no, it's too much.
How about if we plant some lavender as well?
What lavender where?
Down there, no.
No. Please, stop.
I'm not looking over there, don't worry.
Edward finally manages to usher Anna in the direction of the till.
Merci beaucoup. Au revoir. The shopping trip went very well.
Yeah. But I don't think I really reined you in very well, did I? Yeah, I was expecting to maybe come and spend a couple of €100, but it went more than double that. So it's been an expensive trip, but it will really brighten things up and make things look a lot better. So it's worth it.
Anna can now start planting up around the pool while Edward faces tiling a roof for the first time ever to complete the new lean-to. In central France, Belinda and Lee's old tool shed, Lee has had some more ideas about the layout.
This is your bedroom here.
So you're going to draw the ground floor now?
That is the ground floor. And then what we can do is, I was thinking the bathroom or shower room could be here.
Yeah.
Now he and Terry will have to turn the plans into reality.
Right, OK, Terry. Yes?
The support beams for a new first floor are expected today, but Lee is still unsure about how to fit in the stairs.
2.42. So that's the top rung there. No, it's the same. They're coming too close to the entrance door.
Right, the woodyard have just phoned.
Oh, yeah.
And it's on its way.
Fantastic.
I could just about hear him over the sound of the sawmill that's going on, but it's on its way now, all right.
Yeah, we've got a bit of a problem, I think. When we made the staircase,
yeah,
we measured it from here, which means cutting this beam.
Right.
I don't want to cut that beam because it's been there for 400 and odd years.
No, we don't want to cut that beam.
And it's as solid as a rock. Yeah. As soon as I start cutting that...
No, you shouldn't do that because you'll destabilise it.
But we've measured the stairs from here
yeah.
to this yellow line here, which is roughly where this is.
Right, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which works because when you walk through the door,
still got enough
you
room.
Open the door and you've got enough room
to get to the stairs.
Walk here and to walk to the left. Up the stairs or walk to the left into the lounge or walk to the right into the kitchen diner. Right. However, if we don't cut that beam, the stairs comes to here.
That won't work at all.
Can you get a steeper staircase that wouldn't protrude into the room so much?
I'm just thinking, Leah, the staircase that we had in the house in Normandy, that was quite steep.
To double-check that a steeper staircase will work, they mock it up using Terry's scaffold tower and ladder.
So it's going to be there?
Roughly. Well, that's
okay.
The staircase.
That's fine.
You can walk up that.
Of course you can.
But just as one problem is solved, another is around the corner as the beams for the new upper floor arrive.
C'est tombé! Encore! Yeah!
I don't think we're going to be able to lift this already, don't we?
Of course you will, Malcolm.
Ready? I can't. I can't physically lift it.
Big bit of wood. I'm going to get gloves on.
For an extra pair of hands to try to shift the heavy beams, Lee calls in Dave, the gardener.
Oh, this is a first for me. I've never done it before.
My hands up.
Yeah. We're just trying to lift it. I can't.
With chains and pulleys to maneuver one beam at a time into the sheet.
On your toes.
Once they eventually do get the seven beams inside, the next challenge will be to raise them into position to create the new first floor of the sheet.
This could take forever, isn't it?
Still to come. Ben gets his hands on the big guns.
I can imagine I turn this on and bounce off the...
Edward makes a schoolboy error.
I've put a load down and I've not nailed them in.
Oh well, learning on the job. You'll have to take them all off.
In the central Creuse area, Vanessa is working from home while the conversion of the old laundry into a gym and cinema room continues. Having made short work of knocking down the walls...
Show me what we press.
Pick it up.
Ben and handyman Paul are trying to get rid of the concrete plinths that used to support the industrial washing machines.
I can't hear a thing.
Good.
Still a full-time barrister, Ben's steadily building up his DIY skills.
I can imagine I turn this on and bounce off the end.
Yeah. Great. All right.
Straight down to silence.
The solid concrete blocks must be removed so they can lay heating pipes in the floor. And despite this being his first time using a pneumatic drill, Ben soon turns the first plinth to rubble.
Well done.
Nice.
They're going to leave the next stage to the underfloor heating specialists. So when all the debris from their demolition is cleared, work on the old laundry is put on hold, and it's on to the next job in the grounds.
Well, we've got a big hole in the wall here. It used to have a piece of blue string across to keep the cows out. We decided we needed something a bit more substantial. So I got Paul to make us some brand new gates.
All right.
We're going to do some lifting, and now we've just got to put them in the space. Paul is the man who can. Paul's my go-to. If it's too big for me to fix, then he comes and sorts it out.
Put it down there. Okay.
And he can do welding, and
it goes on the pin at the bottom first. So if you lift it up,
and then we've just got a bolt to put in here.
Hold it there for 2 seconds while I get it.
Not too many seconds.
It's not heavy.
Now the gates are level.
That's fine.
Paul welds up the fixings.
Right, so just bob it on there. Right.
It's catching on that wedge.
Once I've got this in, then we can mess with it.
It looks straight. So that's our old gate down there. The magic blue string.
Et voila.
Super.
Thank you.
Paul has even put the initials of Chateau de Jolibois on the new side gates. And with them proudly in position, Ben shows Vanessa that at least one of their many jobs is complete.
Ready? I can't wait to see this. Where are you?
Yeah, don't walk off the edge. Are you ready for the,
I'm
for
ready.
The gate?
No more blue string.
No more blue string.
Ready?
Ready? It's got the JB on everything.
Cool. And how's the JB, which matches with our chimney? Don't cry.
I'm just thinking, God, small piece by small piece.
And this is ticked off the list. Well done.
You got the rest of the list?
The next renovation is already beckoning, as they've got plans for another outbuilding they want to host a party in just a few weeks' time. In southwest France, Edward and Anna are back at the poolside, hard at work on their bar area. As well as continuing work on the new lean-to, they also need to plant their purchases from the garden centre.
Where do you want this creeper plant, then?
Well,
what is it? Jasmine?
Jasmine, yes. Well, just here, so it can go round this post and then climb up after eventually.
Yeah, you can put some branches along there as well.
Yeah.
Okay, about here?
Yes, that sounds good.
Anna retrieves the first jasmine that's been soaking nearby.
Oh, it's looking a lot better.
They were pretty much dry. They're looking really bad, so Ed decided to drench them in the lake. And now they're looking much better. We decided to go for this type of jasmine because it's going to look nice all year round, not lose the leaves too much, but also they climb, and that's going to make it for me. That's going to look beautiful.
Are you happy with the height of that, yeah?
Yes.
These plants hopefully look good because we spent a lot of money on them. Once they're established, I'm sure they'll look amazing. It's just right now, they just look like...
It's just the start.
With the greenery in place around the pool edges, Anna and Edward can turn their attention back to the pool house. They've laid crossbeams on the timber frame of the lean-to, ready for the new roof.
I've never tiled before. I have prepared well, though, and there shouldn't be too many problems. I'm going to need one of those double ones in a minute.
Yeah, just tell me when.
They've chosen the tiles to match the local style, and novice tiler Edward wants to make sure they will stand up to the elements, especially after recent storms.
Before we re-roofed the chateau, we had this huge gust of wind, and the tiles started from the bottom and just lifted. And it So it's kind of the bottom tile that's really important, so I'll probably nail in some of these bottom tiles. But now I'm saying that, I've put a load down and I've not nailed them in. Oh well, learning on the job, I'm going to have to take them all off.
The rookie mistake will cost the couple some time.
Not easy once you put them down.
But when managing a chateau of this size, every day's a school day.
We're always having to learn new skills, especially Ed. Now it's like, oh, I have to do roof tiles, I'm doing roof tiles. I have to do plastering, I'm doing plastering. So there's always a new skill that you have to learn when living and being in the chateau.
Just a week before their first wedding party arrives, Edward now needs to relay the tiles and nail them down securely. And as is normal in chateau life, it may not be the last spanner in the works. Back in central France.
Sing us a sea shanty.
After a struggle with chains and pulleys, the new oak beams for Belinda and Lee's sheet conversion are almost all inside.
Come on, just give us one more shaft. Nice. Easy, told ya.
The next challenge for Lee and his helpers is to raise the half-ton main beam for the new first floor 7 feet up and fix it to the walls.
Well, there you go. Bit flopsy-wopsy.
So the plan to get it up is we've got a scaffold tower. We're going to put the chain pulley hoist to a high-level scaffold beam and then literally lift it up between the three of us using the chain pulley hoist into position and then swing it into the hole that's been made.
But the tower is only designed to support a person or two, not half a ton of oak.
There are some funny noises. Everybody all right?
It's collapse while the beams up in full height.
Up to that stone.
Yeah. Right. So where's it at height? I'll come to these and just give it a push.
But as the beam reaches its highest point, there's a new problem.
Hang on, are we touching this?
That's not real way in.
It's what? Weird.
Hitting this stone.
A large stone is stopping it from sliding into place, leaving the scaffold tower supporting the whole weight of the beam.
Let's go come out.
Get out and lower it.
They quickly pull the beam out and support it with acro props to take some of the weight.
All right, get hammer and see what happens.
Get hammer and chisel.
Yeah.
Thank you.
is only sitting in by about 20 mil. We've got to take... Dave's up there now taking some rocks out because it needs to go into 200 mil.
Yep.
So it's only 10% lying on, resting on the lintel.
As the offending stone falls away, the boys get ready for another try.
Lift it up, push it in. So,
just wait till Dave's clear first.
Yeah. Going down with the acro. Ready, Dave?
Yeah.
One, two, three. Right, I'll have to loosen the chain again. Got that absolutely okay. Can we?
Yeah,
bit. Got a bit more chainage. Emo?
Do it that a little bit. Actually, probably don't. I don't think
it's
going to be much more.
I don't think so either. Looks like it's actually gone right in. It's a good 200 mil in there, isn't it?
With the end secured in the newly widened hole, and a bit of gentle adjusting to straighten it, the main beam of the new upper floor is finally in place.
Scaffolding can go down and everything now, can't it?
I don't think.
How's it going, Lee?
Well, come in and have a look.
Ooh, hold on. It's beginning to take shape, isn't it?
It gives you an idea now.
It does. Stairs. It really does, yeah.
I'll tell you what, what's really amazed me is I've always considered this to be quite a small tool shed. And now we've cleared it out, we're going to get virtually a two-bedroom house in here. Oh, it's amazing.
But with the rest of the floor to finish and all the rooms still to create, there's certain to be a few more challenges ahead before the gîte is ready for guests. Coming up...
I don't want the brambles in my face. Let's have a look.
Ben hits the jackpot.
There's your bar top made. Oh, what a result.
And Dead...
Watch this.
What? No one's going to hang on it.
Can't leave it like that.
But what are you going to do?
East of Poitiers, at Ben and Vanessa's, work to turn an old laundry room into a gym and cinema is on hold while they wait for underfloor heating to be installed. But today, Ben and handyman Paul are starting a new project in one of the many outhouses.
We're just going to put this in the dining room. I think we should put it in the kitchen, yeah.
What we've got to do is get one of the garages ready to become a gin bar. So the first thing that we've got to do is take the ceiling down, and then we've got to fix the walls, and then obviously I've got to build the bar.
They've been using the garage as a junk store, but with a party to host in a few weeks, they want the space transformed.
It is quite a big undertaking, but everything here is quite a big undertaking, so I feel like I'm used to starting these big things. Finishing it is the daunting part of it.
I want to take those two boards, those fireboards down first. Okay, right. That way.
With the room cleared, the next job is to remove the plasterboard ceiling to see what's underneath.
I think you can reach those on just above your head, Ben.
What we don't quite know is exactly what we're going to uncover when we take the plasterboard off the ceiling. Because the idea is we'll expose these beams and then we'll reinstate the ceiling in between the beams so it has more of a sort of rustic look. But we don't know what state the beams are in or what else is up there. It's split, isn't it?
Yeah.
Just put it down like that anyway.
I wonder what that's for.
Wiring for the light.
Ha! No, don't tip it towards me.
Come on!
I want to tip it that way.
What they'd like to find are old beams, but as the boards come down, that's not what Paul discovers.
It's not an old original oak floor, which is what I hoped we were going to find out when we dug in there.
It's chipboard, isn't it?
It's chipboard and new beams.
Yeah. Oh, well.
Hello.
It's not just the boys hoping to uncover some original features.
I was expecting it to be some kind of gorgeous oak thing. Anyway, so if it's not, it's not.
The question is, do we carry on and rip down a perfectly well-insulated, nicely made, relatively new ceiling? Or do we fix this and then fake some beams that go across, basically screw something up on the outside rather than uncover something very new on the inside?
We can.
can do that.
Okay.
The building is so old, and so I'm constantly having to reconcile that with the fact that it's been redone. There were people that were living here, and they have done things to it. So my vision of uncovering old beams and it being really beautiful is often, I'm often having to recalibrate. I think it would be a waste of their time to take it down, and I don't want to add a burden that is unnecessary to them. Like, it just doesn't make sense.
On the hunt for any aged wood they could use to give the gin bar a vintage look, Ben thinks it might be worth exploring the old chicken shed in the grounds.
Wow. This is huge. Right, okay, well, I'm coming in.
But the first thing they spot won't be for the ceiling.
I mean, that'll make a lovely bar top, that one.
It would, actually.
Oh, it's amazing the treasure you find, isn't it?
Okay.
The oak section is about 10 feet long and in great condition, despite having lain abandoned in the shed for probably a decade.
Should we put it down? Well, this whole area was completely covered in brambles, and it was only last summer that we actually broke through and cut it back enough and realised that shed has got, it looks like an oak tree that's just been sliced up into big, thick planks.
Oh, that's quite the bar top, that.
I was looking to make something that was ultimately going to look a bit like this. So to just find it lying in the shed is incredible. Shall we just sort of get it round, slightly round the corner?
Finding the perfect piece for the new gin bar is a great windfall, but there's still a big job ahead to transform the old garage in time for their upcoming party. Back in Bordeaux, the new roof to Edward and Anna's pool house lean-to is nearly finished. Despite some earlier hiccups, with just the final tile to lay.
There we go. That's the roof done.
Edward has successfully managed his first ever roof tiling job.
What do you think, Anna?
I think it's looking really good.
That's the good news.
It's looking really good, especially from up there as you come down. But even here, come underneath it.
Nice and cool.
Shaded, yeah. I think it's perfect.
But it's not job done yet.
I got a problem.
I don't see a problem.
Watch this.
No one's going to hang on it.
You don't know that. Can't leave it like that.
What are you going to do?
Have a post in the middle.
It's open and it's airy.
How about if we put a post here?
Yeah.
And then we incorporate it into part of the bar area.
That sounds good.
Okay. Right, well, that's that sorted then. I'll have to go get some wood, another piece of wood, and cut it to size and get it in.
With a compromise reached, Edward gets to work on reinforcing the roof with another post. Just a few days ago, the chateau's pool area was exposed to the hot southern sun and lacking colour. Now the pool house has a beautiful new lean-to with a terracotta tiled roof to match the chateau's and a rustic barrel bar for guests to enjoy. The borders of the pool have also been given a new lease of life with the addition of rows of flowering plants and climbers.
The lint is finished. I mean, it's amazing.
You like it?
I do. I love it.
It's a real relief, isn't it, to get that job finished off?
It is. The new flowers against the fence are going to make the area. They'll grow in, and the white of the flowers with the blue of the pool, the ceremony right around the corner, it's going to look fantastic.
With their first wedding of the year in less than a week's time, it won't be long until their guests can experience the inviting new pool area. But for Anna and Edward, there will be plenty more to prepare for the busy season ahead. Next time, a family's renovation project hits the buffers.
Oh,
won't be rolling there. It's too slippery.
Ben and Vanessa have their work cut out as they get party ready.
He is a bit of a perfectionist. And I'm not.
And Belinda and Lee start to feel the pressure.
It's got to be up and ready for the summer season. Otherwise, we're wasting our time.
No chateaus, but still very big renovation jobs in Help We Bought a Village, which is on All 4. Next year on Channel 4, Moneybags.